So one last thing to consider, now that we have fully seen Fourier analysis for general signals, is what signals are actually used in communication and what we actually do with signals and how we actually represent signals. So a very important distinction which we made in the beginning was between discrete and continuous signal. So just to remind you of the example we used back then, a continuous signal, the example is this parabola shown on the slide, a continuous signal is essentially represented by not just infinitely many components, but they're infinitely closely spaced. And so on this slide on the left, you see this parabola, which is a continuous function. So the points are infinitely closely spaced, and you cannot really say which point is next to another because there are infinitely many points in any interval. Whereas on the right, you have a discrete signal. So you have, again, you have the same shape, general, but you have just a few points, and each point, you can say this is the first point, this is the second point, so it is enumerable in a sense. Now, we saw in the Fourier series and Fourier transformations that the difference between a discrete and a continuous spectrum would be a periodic or a non-periodic signal, but it's actually very important to understand how we can represent one with the other because of one very sad truth, and that is the fact that all machines operate with discrete quantities. What do I mean by this is that, in fact, we cannot truly represent a continuous signal as such, since in any machine we have a definite resolution. So any machine would have a limit below which it cannot differentiate between values. So if you thought of, for example, if you had an antenna, a receiving antenna, and if your receiver was registering the electromagnetic field by measuring the volts, for example, what you're gonna get is some thresholds below which it would not be able to differentiate. So for example, if you have a sensor which is sensitive to a few nanovolts, if you had picovolts pouring in, you could not detect that. So even if there were oscillations, even if there was information which was below this threshold, you would never measure it. And so effectively, any signal will be discrete because we only have discrete intervals in which we can measure, which is defined by our resolution, by our ability to differentiate between two levels. Intuitively, in the discrete case of the signals, we have definite number of points, so we have a finite number of points, whereas in the continuous case, we have infinitely many, infinitely closely packed points. So how can we describe one with the other? How can we go between the two? Well, the answer is with a procedure known as digitalization. So just to give an example of how a machine sees a signal, and to give an example of how we may go between discrete and continuous, let's consider this simplest sine function, which we have been working with for a very long time now, and it's quite familiar. So this sine function, taken from minus twice pi to plus twice pi, this may be how it actually is, but how a machine would see it is in this grid, which we have placed over it here. So a machine would have a definite time step, and it would have a definite signal step. So it would see it at every given point, it would see values. So it will not really see the full continuous function, it would see a set of values, each one corresponding to this grid. So a machine, any digital device we have right now, would not be able to see the signal as a continuous thing, but only as a discrete number of points. And in fact, digitalization is the process of taking a continuous or an analog signal and turning that into something discrete, which can actually be represented by bits or by any other devices which may be used as information carriers. So we've mentioned before what bits are. We have also mentioned that in practice most systems use bits or binary units in a way that we have two-state systems, and we have many, many two-state systems, and each one of those is a bit. So a bit can be a 0 or a 1, equivalently on or off, depending on how you define that, and we have shown in the past that a total of n bits would carry 2 by the power of n in terms of states, possible states. So let's consider how can we transfer this sine function, this continuous thing, into bits, and how we can turn this continuous function into something which is a sequence of zeros and ones, and which can then be used with digital modulation, as we're going to see soon, to be sent by a transmitter. So first of all, the first part of digitalization is actually quantization. Quantization is the idea of quantizing into bits, into sections, the signal into discrete levels. And so instead of having this continuously varying sine function, we now have a grid again. Now, the grid on the x dimension is actually time, so the signal flowing in, and we sample at given sections of time, whereas on the y direction, we have on the y axis of this plot, we actually have the levels or the amplitude of the signal. So any signal would be discretized both in time and in terms of its magnitude or signal strength, and what we get are these red dots we have shown here indicated. So we only get portions or only get values at the sampling times. So you can think of it as the sine wave flowing and our device measuring at every 0.2 seconds, for example, in this case, and measuring the values, which are the red points. And so our computer, what it actually remembers, or our machine, what it actually gets, is a number, a set of values. And you can see this represented in this plot with only the points. And so it doesn't have the full sine function, it has only a set of points. So it knows that they're evenly spaced in time. So it knows that they're, for example, at 0.2 seconds. And it knows what at each of those times, what the value was. Now, in practice, what we have shown here is not very precise because we're using a square grid. In fact, it may be that one of the dimensions of the grid is much smaller than the rest. So we might have very small time steps and very large intervals depending on the signal itself. We might have varying sizes of both time and signal steps. So we may sample more closely where we know that the function is changing a lot, and we may sample more spread out, if you like. But generally, this is the idea, and this is just a simple representation of that. So having discretized the signal, having quantified it, if you like, what we can do now is we can assign to each subinterval a sequence of bits and or a state. So let's suppose we have 5 bits, and using again our rule that the number of states is 2 by the power of the number of bits, we have 2 by the power of 5 states. And so we can, excluding, for example, the 0, 0 state, we can use the first bit to represent above or below zero. So if we have 1 as the first bit, we're above the zero threshold. If we have 0, we're below. And then the rest of the bits, the other 4 bits, are used to indicate how far. So for example, 0001 for the rest of them would be the first interval just above zero, and so on. Now doing this, we assign to each time step, so to each sampling, we assign a sequence of 5 bits, which tells us first, are we above or below zero? And second, how far above or below zero? And so in a sense, we get this signal, this sine wave, we get it represented as a sequence of those states, as a sequence of those bits. And just to give an example, what our sine wave looks in this specific discretization scheme, in this specific digitalization scheme we looked at, it would be the following sequence of zeros and ones. And this may not look like much now, so it may look just like a crude sequence, but this is something which is very easily translated and very easily conveyed. So you can use this sequence now, and you can use a digital modulation scheme to actually program a wave in such a way to convey this information, to convey these bits, which can then be deciphered on the other end. Now, of course, you may argue, have we actually captured all of the information? So this sine function, we said that as a continuous function, it carries a lot more information in a sense. Intuitively, it carries a lot more than what we can do by taking only discrete portions of it. So how can we be sure that once we send this information, once we send this sequence of zeros and ones, on the other end, by sampling at the exact same speed, even if they reconstruct the points of the signal, how can they reconstruct the full signal? So they're gonna have only a finite number of points, but what about those in between? Well, of course, the reacquirement of the full signal or the reconstruction of the full continuous signal would never be unique if we only had a discrete finite number of points, but there is a special case in which we can actually completely recover a signal after it has been digitalized into its analog form. And this is what is actually given to us by the Nyquist-Shannon theorem we're just going to see in a second. So what does the Nyquist-Shannon theorem tell us? Well, suppose that we have a signal which has a compact frequency domain. So our signal has no frequency larger than some maximum frequency B. And since we have in our representation, we have positive and negative, suppose that we have up to B and up to minus B is the full spectrum of our signals. There is nothing beyond these frequencies. So absolute value of B. And it turns out that we can completely recover our signal as long as our sampling rate, or the rate at which we digitalize, at which we sample the values of the signal, as long as this rate is larger than twice this bandwidth, so twice this B, which is the highest frequency. Now, this too, of course, appears because the total bandwidth is the positive part of the frequency domain plus the negative part. And if we have a total of maximum frequency of B, then taking twice B is exactly what we need to encompass the full bandwidth. And keeping this in mind, we can reformulate this requirement in terms of time. So, since the sampling rate is simply the frequency of sampling, then an equivalent statement would be that our sampling time, or the time step between two samples, should be less than 1 over twice b. And so you see that the requirement is that first of all our signal should have some portion of the spectrum as a domain, so it should not be all over the spectrum, it should not require the full spectrum or something like this. And second of all is that we sample fast enough. So of course if we had an infinite spectrum, then we would need to sample infinitely fast in order to encompass this condition. And so generally a signal with an infinitely large spectrum would not be fully reconstructable after digitalization, as was expected. So just to give you a very important point, this is not an equal or greater equality. It is a strong inequality. What I mean by this is that if we got our rate at exactly twice B, so our sampling rate, we would still not have met the criterion of the Nyquist-Shannon theorem. And you can see, this is actually called the critical frequency, and you can see on the sample below that we had this red sine curve, which was sampled exactly at the critical frequency. And you can see that even at that point, there is still ambiguity, so it's not still uniquely defined. We have several sine functions which fit into the same pattern of points, the same sampling points. So exactly what this theorem tells us is that we should always be better than, so we should have a better than twice B sampling rate, a higher rate, in order to actually convey this information. This is something unique. What it tells us is a very important criterion, and what it tells us is that we can take the continuous signal, we can digitalize it, and as long as we are digitalizing with a high enough sampling rate, as long as we're digitalizing, depending on the signal itself, of course, but as long as we're digitalizing with a high enough sampling rate, we can always reconstruct our signal, and from its digital form, we can get it back to its analog form. And this is very important because, as we're going to see soon, the main idea of digital signal modulation is that we actually use the analog signal, which we record somehow by an external device, again the microphone which you gave as an example before, this signal would then have to be converted to a digital form in order to use digital modulation on the waves we're using. But then, in order to represent this back into a useful form, we need to convert it back into analog, since, for example, if we have speakers, the final way they work, so producing the sound, they're actually gonna need the analog form of the signal. So we see that we need not only to be able to digitalize the signal, but also to recover it, because only a digitalized signal, even though we can send it as digital information, if we cannot recover it later on, it's useless because we are losing information. So just as a basic heads up, as may be expected, even if we do have a higher than the Nyquist-Shannon rate, so even if we follow the theorem, even if our sampling frequency is high enough, there is still some loss, so there is still some noise that comes from the digitalization itself. What it results from is the fact that our computers do not have all of the numbers, so they do not have irrational numbers, they always approximate. So our computers cannot represent any number perfectly. And so, for example, if while sampling, our computer measures for a given point in time a value which is pi, it cannot really measure pi, it cannot really put pi as a value, but what it does is it approximates it with some rational number which is very close, but it's not exactly that. also our intervals, the way that we distributed each value to an interval, what happens with those values which are exactly between two intervals, this may cause, again, some sort of ambiguity. So should it go to the upper interval or to the lower one? This depends on the scheme itself. But what all of these effects, so the imperfections of the way we actually keep this information and the way we gather the information and measure and sample, it results in additional errors which can actually modify the signal. And after reconstructing it, because of those additional errors which were introduced by the computer or the device which stored all of that, we're going to get some fluctuations. And you can see an example of such digitalization noise here in the upper plot. But the good news is that we can always reduce this either by making our threshold smaller, so by having more precise devices which do the sampling and the converting, or by using statistics. So statistically averaging all of those additional digitalization noises, since they have zero mean variance. So they're going to change things as much to one side as they do to the other side. We can actually use statistics if we know how the noises are introduced and clear the signal again. So we can actually get the digitalization noise to a minimum by using additional clearing algorithms.